Hello, I found a decent, or the only decent power supply on AliExpress, so I'm going to introduce it today. This is the DC power supply, DP100 from ALIENTEK. This power supply has a USB-C port that supports USB PD. When I bought it, it was around $45 including shipping fee. These days, AliExpress ships quickly. Their items often arrive in about a week. As you can see, the packet is solid. In the package, there was a hard case. I opened the case once before filming. The contents are these. For this video, I bought the simplest and cheapest set. This is the power supply. It's quite small. These are the power cables and the USB cable. You can connect the power supply to your PC using this cable. And also, for power delivery, there's a USB-C cable for the power adapter. Since the case is pretty solid, it's convenient to carry around. The case is shock-absorbing. It's pretty much possible that this product was made to be carried around. Look at this. It's so thin and small. It's actually really good. An instruction was in the package. How to use and the specifications are described. Basic specifications are written here. The input voltage is from 5 to 32 volts. The input current is 5 ampere maximum. The output voltage is from 0 to 30 volt. The output current is from 0 to 5 amps. The output power is 100 watt maximum. The efficiency is quite high. It says 97% maximum. The resolution of voltage and current is also high. This power supply seems pretty high quality. Let's actually use it. This power supply takes power from USB-C, so you'll need a USB charger to supply power. If you don't have a charger, you can use this cable. It connects USB-C in the AC adapter. This cable came in the set, so you don't need to purchase anything. Recently, most smartphone chargers have USB-C ports, and most of them support PD. Therefore, you don't need anything special to use this power supply. I turned on the power. It's on. Basically, you can use the wheel and the three buttons to operate this device. The operation is sometimes a little confusing, but it can't be helped since there are only three buttons. You'll get used to it. When you connect the device to the power source, it automatically turns on. When you press the button on the left, you can turn off and on the device, but I think it's easier if you make it turn on automatically when connected to the power source. If you press this button on the right, you can see the voltage. When the voltage is displayed, the terminals light up. The output terminal is structured like a screw. You can unscrew it. There's a hole in here. You can insert a resistor there. You can set the voltage if you press the button in the middle. A digit is highlighted. You can select a digit by pressing these buttons and scroll the wheel to change the voltage. Actually, you can operate this pretty easily. If you want to change the current, press the middle button again. You can select the setting by pressing the middle button. If you want to exit the voltage and current settings, long press any button. The right button turns on and off the voltage output. That's about it. It's quite simple to operate. This power supply outputs a voltage that's lower than the input voltage. For example, the input voltage is 9 volt now. The upper limit of the output voltage is 8.78 volt. So the output voltage is always lower than the input voltage. It can't output a higher voltage. I connected it to my USB charger, whose PD voltage limit is 20 volt. The upper limit is around 19.3 volt. Now I'm using the conversion cable for USB-C and the AC adapter that came in the set. It's working without a problem. The input voltage of the currently connected DC power supply is displayed here. This device is probably a simple step-down converter. It lowers the input voltage from USB PD, which is 20 volt, or DC power supply, which is a bit higher, to the specified voltage using the step-down converter inside. Sometimes the USB PD settings change. In that case, press the middle button twice to enter this screen. Check that PD. Volt is set to 20. On the display at the bottom, it says 31.7 in small letters. This is the temperature inside the device. I can't see the circuits inside the device, but probably there's only a step-down converter, so I guess it doesn't get too hot. While I was using it, the temperature didn't exceed 45 degrees. The specification says the maximum efficiency is 97%, which means about 3 watt of heat is generated. 3 watt heat is not a problem for a device of this size. You don't need to worry about it. Next, let's think about the occasions where this power supply comes in handy. Firstly, when you don't own a power supply. If you have a USB charger like this, then all you need to do is to connect it to this ALIENTEK DP100 power supply. You can use what you already have. Most USB chargers support PD recently, so you can use your own charger in most cases. It would be nice to start hobby electronics using this power supply. I built a multi-vibrator circuit. It's working perfectly. Let's go back to the use cases of ALIENTEK DP100. It can help you, for example, when you suddenly need a power supply when you're not at home. Most power supplies draw power from an outlet, and they're large. They are not suitable for carrying around. But this one is, you can use it for a certain variety of cases if you take it with you. Also, when you can't bring a large power supply, in the first place, it's such a pain to carry a power supply around as they are heavy. Even though you need to bring a USB-C charger for power delivery together, this power supply is very small and quite easy to carry around. Also, it can draw power from your PC. Connected to my PC. Now it turned on and displays the voltage. If you have a conversion cable for USB-A2C, then you can use your USB hub. However, the USB port of APC supplies only 5 volt, so the output voltage can be set to less than 5 volt. In my case, 4.92 volt at most. But as long as it's less than 5 volt, you can change the output voltage freely. If your circuit needs less than 5 volt, there's no problem in using this power supply. When you draw power from your PC, make sure that the output voltage and current will be enough for your circuit. Next, let's check the quality of this power supply. I'm going to see whether the displayed current and voltage are accurate or not using these meters. Let's start. The voltage is set to 1 volt. My meter says it's 1.003 volt. It's quite accurate. The displayed current is 0.01 amps. Let's look at the actual current. It's 0.01 amps. Very accurate. Let's raise the voltage to 5 volt. It's 5 volt now. My meter says it's 5.001 volt. Again, very accurate. The displayed current is 0.051 amps. It actually is 0.051 ampere. Very good. I raise the voltage to 15 volt. My meter also says 15.001 volt. The third and fourth decimal places are not stable, but still I would say this is a really good power supply. Very nice. Next, let's try CC mode. We will look at how accurate the output current is on constant current mode. When the current is set to 1 amps, the display says 1.001 amps. The fourth and fifth decimal places are not stable. Let's raise to 2 amps. 2.0000. It's stable up to fourth place. Pretty good. I also set to 3, 4, and 5 amps. I confirm that the voltage and current set on the power supply mostly match the actual amount of voltage and current. Next, let's look at the output voltage of this power supply and see how much voltage fluctuation and noise is generated. The output voltage is 5 volt, and I connected a 10 ohm resistor. The wireless microphone I'm using affects the waveform when it gets close. I'll put it as far as possible. The measurement method affects the waveform as well. I'm using this passive probe. I'm using this one with a ground spring, because lead's length is short. The left waveform shows the AC component of the output voltage. You can see something like voltage spikes. This is what is called switching noise. This waveform shows 5 microseconds per column, so the switching frequency seems to be about 200 kHz. The right waveform is the filtered version. You can't measure the switching noise on this one, but you can see the ripple. The switching noise is about plus minus 30 to 40 millivolt, by the way. Let's look at the voltage ripple. There you go. This enlarged waveform shows 1 millivolt per row. The voltage ripple is about 1 millivolt. This is very good. The ripple's quite small. The background noise of the oscilloscope and probe looks like this. Let's also look at the rise and fall of the voltage. This is the voltage when turned off. It abruptly drops. Turn the voltage on. The voltage is set to 5 volt, and the resistance is 10 ohm. The voltage rises nicely without any overshoot. Now let's disassemble this power supply and see the structure inside. There are rubber pads on the backside. If you remove these, you can easily disassemble this device. Special screws are used here. I remove the bottom cover. A lot of components are packed inside. It seems to be quite solid. This is the wheel that controls the waveband. There are banana sockets here. When you insert a plug, a lot of force is applied to the terminals, so the terminals are fixed using screws. Then thread locking adhesive is applied on the screws to prevent them from loosening. It seems to be assembled pretty neatly. Let's remove the adhesive. They're attached firmly, but you can remove by force. Done. Once the screws are removed, you can remove the circuit board. There, looks solid. A circuit board for the screen is connected with a flat cable. There is another circuit board. This is the output board. It's connected to the main board with a pin header. I'll disconnect the cable. There. A shield case is placed on top of this board. When I saw this shield, I found it very unique. This is not soldered on the board. There are clips on the board for securing the shield. I'm unclasping those clips. It's interesting. I've never seen such a shield. Inside the shield case, there's an inductor and electrolytic capacitors. This inductor is a toroidal inductor. This type of inductor radiates less electromagnetic noise. This shield prevents the noise emission, so even less noise is emitted. Let's look at the backside of the shield case. Can you see? Heat conductive sheets are used. This shield case acts as a heat dissipation measure, not only as a shield. I drew an approximate circuit diagram. This circuit is a common step-down converter circuit. This part is the voltage input, and this part is the output. There's also a MOSFET for cutting off the output, but I didn't draw it here. The inductor is here, and electrolytic capacitors are at the input. There are several more electrolytic capacitors at the output. These are MOSFETs. They are placed on the back side, here and here. High-quality MOSFETs are used. Their on-resistance is 5 milliohm. As we checked earlier, the switching frequency is approximately 200 kilohertz. Probably the switching frequency is fixed. These electrolytic capacitors are mostly made by Chinese manufacturers. For these hybrid capacitors, I'm not sure which manufacturer made them. My impression after disassembling this power supply is that it is quite well made. The arrangement of components is thought through. Also, the overall robustness and texture is quite nice. Today, I tried using, measuring, and disassembling this ALIENTEK DP100. My impression is that it's a quite well-made power supply. When I checked the list price on AliExpress, it was $95. I purchased it for $45, including shipping. At this price, this power supply is a must-buy. At the list price of $95, there are alternatives, I think. However, the portability is a huge advantage, because it's compatible with USB PD. All you need is the power supply and a USB charger. It's very easy to carry them around. Thank you for watching.